So good afternoon, dear colleagues and friends. I'm really very happy to welcome Experimental Jet Set, an Amsterdam-based graphic design studio here in Kyiv, as the continuation of the Kyiv International 68 now. Just paraphrasing the titles of one of your exhibitions to shortly introduce the collective, just two or three things you have to know about Experimental Jet Set. So this collective was founded in 1997 by Marike Stolk, Erwin Brinkers, who is unfortunately couldn't come to Kyiv for health reasons, and Danny van den Dungen, focusing mainly on printed matter and site-specific installations. Experimental Jet Set have worked on projects for a wide variety of institutes across the globe, including Stedelijk Museum in Amsterdam, Centre Pompidou, Dutch Post Group, and Whitney Museum of American Art. Their work has been featured in such group shows as Graphic Design, now in production at the Walker Art Center in 2011, and Ecstatic Alphabets, Heaps of Language at MoMA in 2012. Some of the recent exhibitions of the collective include two or three things I know about Provo, World Things in Time Space, Provo Station, which took place in the Museum of Contemporary Art in Leipzig, and the last one that they will concentrate predominantly today is called the Superstructure. In 2007, a substantial selection of work by Experimental Jet Set was acquired by the Museum of Modern Art in New York and other institutes that have collected Experimental Jet Set material include Stedelijk Museum, San Francisco MoMA, Art Institute of Chicago, Milwaukee Art Museum, Museum für Gestaltung in Zurich, and others. In 2015, Roma publication in Amsterdam released a monograph, a book by Experimental Jet Set entitled Statement and Counterstatement, Notes on Experimental Jet Set. Between 2000 and 2013, Experimental Jet Set have been teaching at the Gerrit Rietveld Academy in Amsterdam, and currently they are teaching at the Artes Werkplatz Typografie in Arnhem. What is really super important for us is that Experimental Jet Set have kindly agreed to be the designers of the Kyiv International Kyiv Biennial 2017 and the second edition, this one, 68 now. And also they designed the guidebook of the Kyiv International, which you can buy today with a special proposition only for 100 hryvnias. I strongly recommend you. And the topic of today's presentation is called Superstructure. It's basically their ongoing research into the notion of the city as a graphic language, and they will focus on mainly on four main themes, which are constructivism, the situationist international, Provo movement, and post-punk. Thank you so much again for coming. Welcome and have a nice talk.
Well, thank you for coming, and thanks to FACIL and FICRC for organizing the Kyiv International. We are Experimental Jet Set from Amsterdam and incomplete.
Yeah, although, I mean, it's true that Erwin is not here for health reasons, but it's not that serious. He does have a bit of a flu, but we didn't want to contaminate every one of you with that, so he's perfectly normal. Next time when we are here, or if you are here another time, he will be here as well. So it's not that serious. Well, it's funny because of course Vasil already introduced us completely. I mean, when you start thinking about the lecture, you always think, oh yeah, first we have to introduce ourselves, and then we're gonna start with the lecture. But of course, now the whole introduction has already been done perfectly, by the way. So
yeah, it's always a bit embarrassing, to be honest.
To be introduced.
Yeah.
Now it's sort of hard to find the right start to get into the
Actual lecture.
To get into the lecture again. We're as always totally nervous, by the way. We're really bad in doing lectures. We asked Vasil, when he invited us, he said, oh, let us do some kind of installation or some kind of mural or anything but a lecture, but he insisted that it should be a lecture, so here we are and ready to roll. We heard it can take up, we can take up 2 hours actually, which is an extremely long time, so don't feel ashamed to leave if we just keep on rambling and rambling. It will be like a sort of Grateful Dead concert in length or something. Just a marathon
Could you just start then?
Can we just start then? Okay. Let's start with the what connects us now to this event here, which is the Kyiv Biennial, the Kyiv International, for which we designed the emblem. It's actually the whole system of emblems in a way. Here you can only see 12. It's actually 24, like an hour system basically. And it's actually a sort of repurposed thing. We already designed this in 2015 as part of an exhibition in Zurich for the Museum für Gestaltung, the design museum there. And it was actually called, the theme of the exhibition was the international style, which is, as you might know, a specific sort of Swiss way of using typography with grids and Helvetica and stuff. It's something people often lump us in that camp of that sort of late modernist, structuralist, that Swiss idea of design, although we don't actually feel connected to it. But we still had to make some kind of work with it. And we were sort of lost when we made this. And we made this mural without actually precisely knowing what we did. But
I agree.
Yeah. But it now completely found its real place here in this context. Which is also something that is quite interesting. That sometimes, when we were just starting out, we always thought that we should make stuff as site-specific as possible, and we didn't want to be sort of reusing stuff. And now more and more we realize that often stuff gains something when it sort of travels through different contexts, and it actually maybe finds a much better place in a new context. So this idea of repurposing, which is also quite interesting maybe about this whole the 68 now, but also what we have seen from the Kyiv International, this sort of repurposing of these old modernist buildings. Maybe this repurposing is actually a much better purpose than the original purpose was.
So, but it was actually Fasil who asked us if he could use it. Which made us think that it would be actually quite a nice idea, also because it talks about space and time and words.
It's also funny that the whole meaning of international changes together with this actual clock, in the sense that the first time the international was used in connection to this idea of this Swiss international style, and then the second time it got this much more political meaning. So it's sort of returning, well, first as a tragedy, then as a farce, as the saying goes, or something. So it's a sort of nice return and a sort of this whole repurposing thing is quite interesting. Then we made the moving version, which we also thought was quite an interesting thing. Of course, it's a clock. We actually wrote a little piece in that book that Vasil just announced, in which we explain sort of like the ideas behind the clock, or we sort of meditate or reflect a little bit on the meaning of it.
And, actually, also the book is a repurposing of a template of our own book.
For our monograph, yeah. Actually. The whole, we were all in the mood of this repurposing thing, and we had our own monograph, which Vasil mentioned, a statement and counter statement, which is a black book. And then we were asked to make a template for this book, and then we thought, maybe it should be just the same, and it's now like a white book. So it's also in itself a statement and counter-statement, a white book and a black book. So it's it's pure laziness. I mean, I know that when we, there was at a certain point last year, there was an interview with us on an Ukrainian website, and as a reaction on that, I noticed that on Facebook there was some kind of discussion among Ukraine graphic designers. Mm-hmm. We were tagged, or how do you call it? Somehow we could see that we were being mentioned in some kind of online discussion, and we watched it, and of course we had to translate it to see it, and it was more like, oh, it's a typical experimental jet set, so lazy, just sort of using something again, and well, maybe it is, you know, there's also a value maybe in this
laziness. Actually, we think it's quite important to take your time seriously and use it as sparse as possible. So actually it's quite good to take it as slow.
It's also in the spirit of recycling.
Exactly.
and sustainability.
Yeah. There's only so much energy to left,
to spend,
right?
On, yeah, something.
Better use it wisely.
The spiraling thing, we remember that Vasil also mentioned storms, and you know, hurricanes.
Yeah.
At the time, maybe there were hurricanes in the States, and you saw these maps on the television of these storming, spiraling across the country. And recently we came across, there's this online magazine called The Charnel House, and there was a review of a book, which I haven't read that particular book, but it was a book about spirals and the meaning of spirals in contemporary culture and art. It was, and now I really have to look, by this guy called Nico Israel, and it was called Spirals, the World Image in 21st Century Culture and Art. And there, in that review, it was discussed that the image of the spiral plays quite an important role in that review, Hegel is mentioned, and Marx and Lenin. Apparently they all use the image as a spiral, as a sort of symbol for dialectical progress. I hope then they are talking about something outward spiraling instead of inward spiraling, because otherwise it becomes a little bit too narrow.
Although you are safe in the eye of the hurricane, I think.
The eye of the sign of the eye of the, yeah, that's true. So all these things sort of play with this idea of the spiraling. Also that, of course, Tatlin's Tower, which we will discuss later, also had this sort of spiraling movement. So for us it all hangs sort of more or less together, the clock, the idea of the international, the spiraling shape. So when we were asked for the 68 Now emblem, we also just sort of referred to that. It's sort of annoying maybe that the moment that 68 turns, it becomes 89. And that's why we're thinking, actually 68 should have taken place in 69. It's 69, when you look at the number itself and you turn 69, it becomes 69 again. So there is already something inherently revolutionary about the number 69. It can be rotated. So when you think about it, 68 should have happened in 69. That should be much better. But
we'll blame it on the French.
We blame it on the French. that's true. So superstructure. This is a subject we actually wanted to talk about. It's we realized it much later, that superstructure actually also was something, an exhibition that took place here within the context also of the Visual Culture Research Center in 2014, I thought. It's pure coincidence in a way. We were thinking of a title, and we actually had to come up with the title even a little bit before we were exactly sure what the exhibition would be about, I think, because mm-hmm. they already wanted to advertise it, the people in Melbourne, and we thought superstructure is a nice sort of container word, and a lot of what we do can be sort of put in that container. So we wrote a text about this whole exhibition that is used as an introduction to that exhibition. And we have the text with us. this is actually the real narrative. If he would have been proper academic, he would have just read this text, and that would be like a very straightforward, nice, neat story. But instead of that, we have it with us as a pamphlet, and we're going to hand it out to you right now.
We tried readings before, but we always sort of sidetrack at one point and then lose every moment.
So we thought if we're going to hand out the pamphlet now to you, then you have the main text, and this lecture will be just footnotes in a way, and the whole fragmentary nature of what we're going to present will suddenly be totally justified because it will be just footnotes to the main text. So we're going to hand the pamphlet out to you now. It's also a nice performative gesture, the handing out of the of the pamphlet. It's also some good exercise during the sitting here to actually.
I have some more oxygen now. Although my voice is dropping, I don't know. Must be nerves or something.
Maybe we should do some force exercises before we start now. So yeah, Superstructure in Melbourne. First, a sort of overview of the exhibition itself before we delve into the four themes of which the exhibition consisted. We were actually asked to do an exhibition about our own work, retrospective. But we thought this was such a nice space. Actually, there were two spaces like this. This is only the first space that you see. It was such a nice opportunity for us to sort of finally look into some of the subjects we have been interested in for quite a while. Because we are not really academics or schoolers, we're quite sort of practicing, I don't know, jobbing graphic designers, really sort of going from project to project and from assignment to assignment. So we always try to see every assignment as an opportunity to also do research, and sometimes this works better than other times, and this was for us an opportunity to maybe take a big leap and really try to look at all of our past researches in a more sort of coherent way.
Yeah, although it's not really sunken in yet. I mean, we didn't have the time to sort of take a distance to understand what we did there, I think.
Maybe you should say when it actually took place.
Yeah, when was it? Oh, it was in March.
Put it there on the pamphlet.
24th of March.
It opened the 16th of March.
16th.
Yeah, until the 5th of May. So, which also is nice that it still overlaps with the whole May 68 thing, because it also plays a part of it. So, in general, four themes, four movements that have influenced us. And we were looking specifically into the ways in which all these four movements use the city as a platform for language. This might seem a bit far-fetched, but it really comes from our earlier research into the Provo movement. And we will come to the Provo movement later, but this movement has been quite important to us. And what he found especially attractive is how this movement, a Dutch anarchist movement that existed between 65 and 67, so actually a couple of years before the French 68 movement. And we were especially interested in how they found a way to use Amsterdam almost as a system of communication, to use the public space almost as a sort of device to communicate, basically. At a certain point, we often refer to it as how they use the city almost like a metaphysical printing press, sort of multiplying ideas and enlarging ideas. So that was something we've been working on already a couple of years ago on a couple of exhibitions on the Provo movement. And for the Melbourne exhibition, we were thinking of if we could use this principle and also apply it to some other movements we've been quite interested in. So it was kind of like an experiment to see if we could use that same method also for other movements.
It looks like a big chaos, actually, from here.
It looks quite messy, but more people remarked that, right?
Yeah.
We thought it was quite ordered and structured, but
it's funny if you look in the mirror, right?
It's quite a modular thing, by the way. All the panels that you see are all the same panels, all variations on the same structure, right? That the shapes that you see on the front, the colors first of all refer to those four themes, so there was a sort of color-coded system, but those angular shapes that you see refer to the construction of the backside of those panels, and they all were different, but all within a specific how do you call it? Within a specific parameter thingy. I don't know. Anyway, I don't know. This was the exhibition, basically. Okay, but maybe interesting is how we then solve the problem of showing our own work, because we still had this obligation in that exhibition to show our own work, which is then ridiculous because you show all these grand movements, big historical movements, and then you come with your little printed matter thingy. So you feel that you somehow are completely nothing compared to those bigger movements. Mm.
I don't have that problem.
Oh, maybe I'm more.
I think it's really interesting to show that things come from certain ideas that were ahead of you in time, right?
True. No, absolutely.
which still are taken on the road to the future.
It actually emphasizes your depth to these movements when you show them next to each other.
I also think that these objects become really small and frail, but that's also quite nice to show that some things are really very
I'm also trying to find the English word for nietig. Nothing like in Dutch, but yeah. It is nietig as in very frail, very small in a way, tiny.
So you should protect those things, maybe.
We put them on the backside of those panels, basically. So the exhibition has two sides, the historical side, which is the front side, and then the retrospective side, which is the back side. And all our work is basically on the back side, also as some kind of, you know, the symbolical idea that we are just in the background of it, or just footnotes to these bigger historical movements. Although there's still this strange tension between our own work and these historical movements, which you will also notice in this lecture, because in this lecture this combination will also be apparent. But it's maybe in that friction that something interesting happens. Maybe if it would be a completely historical exhibition, it would also be maybe predictable, and if it would be like a completely retrospective exhibition, it would have been totally vain. So maybe in that sort of tension between the two, something interesting happens. So we were thinking about these four quarters in a way. We like the word quarter maybe because it refers both to location and to time. You know, you have quarter as in Le Quartier Latin, or you know, the quarter in a city, also the quarter in 15 minutes of an hour. So in that sense, the whole exhibition also works as a clock, basically. We're quite obsessed with clocks recently, so maybe it's our age that it has to do with some kind of fear
time
of mortality.
Is running,
or
time
something.
Is running fast.
The constructivist city, this is the first theme. So we're just going to talk you through some of the images that we found interesting. And if you really want to have the coherent narrative, then it's basically in the pamphlet that we just gave you. I think the first image that we found really important to use in the exhibition was the Tatlin Tower, which monument to the Third International, which is such a sort of emblem for constructivism, also has a sort of tragic side to it, which is also emblematic of constructivism, we think, because it's basically a failed, you can see it as a failed project because it was never realized. And a lot of those quite famous constructivist projects have never been actually realized. Although it's a matter of course, how you look at it. You might as well say that they may have been never realized in real scale, but they did exist as scale models in printed matter, and maybe in that sense, in how it was distributed later through media and through books and through magazines, it might have a bigger impact than maybe when it was originally built, and it would have been now completely ruined. And maybe it's not a good way to think about these projects as failed, because they only exist as sort of paper architecture or scale models, and because maybe that is almost the most utopian form something can take. And we were quite interested in how this Tatlin Tower, his sort of existence as a scale model. Here you see it being constructed. I mean, this is already like architecture in itself. It has the size of a kiosk. It is a scale model, but at the same time, it is also pretty much a real construction. So it's sort of diffusing the borders between real architecture and scale architecture.
Huh? Maybe the reason why we show it like this is also how we use the images in the exhibition. We show that all the images come from books. We did this with a purpose, of course. Well, the idea not to show an image and misuse it, to bring people into a different world, but to show them that it's actually just an image printed on a piece of paper, and that everything is in the end in books.
Yeah, so all the images that we use in the exhibition were all also shown like this, as scanned images from a book. And indeed, as Marieke explained, it's very important for us also in our whole graphic design practice or something. We always want to emphasize almost the material dimension of things, that in the end things are just ink on paper. So we don't want people to get lost in the illusion of the image, basically. There's always something iconoclastic in our work, in the sense that we always want to sort of destroy people's illusion of the image. So in this exhibition we did it by only showed really scanned images. It is also the reason we see this image pretty sharp here on our screen, but on some of the images above, it looked pretty moiréed. Do you know moiré, when two screens, two rasters get overlapped?
Well, it gets even more destroyed than the image.
It gets even more destroyed, so it's even better. It's even more Brechtian here on the big screen, but it looks sharper on our little screen, actually. But this looks pretty okay. But it's just basically the resolution of the beamer sort of interfering with the resolution of the image. And then you get sometimes these unexpected patterns. Still the scale model of the Tatlin Tower. The Tatlin Tower for us has to do with language for a couple of reasons. I mean, first of all, we have quite an eccentric definition of language. We just see it more as a sort of system of signs in general. So even a system of buildings, or, you know, as in the constructivist movement, they developed this whole typology of kiosk and tribunes and pavilions, and there's that whole typology, street furniture, stands, billboards, and for us that is almost works as a sort of language in itself, because it's almost like signs that they put in the street. And with the Tatlin Tower, there's an added dimension that it was actually, one of the functions that it had was also that it would be a radio transmitter, transmitting live the Comintern, the Communist International that would take place underneath. So it is also like a device to spread communication. So in that sense, we also saw it pretty much as part of a sort of linguistic form of architecture, in a way. Apart from the fact that the spiraling form could also represent this whole idea of dialectical progress. So it also had an almost rhetorical function, which is also almost like a sort of linguistic function. And what's also, I mean, we were this afternoon, when we were going through the lecture, and suddenly we saw, of course, the change from Petrograd to Leningrad, and suddenly we think, oh, that's also quite interesting. We are talking about how language sort of manifests itself in the city, but the change from Petrograd to Leningrad, it basically shows you something opposite, how the city manifests itself in language, how the name of a city, while the city remains the same, how the name of a city changes. That's the change from 1920 to 25, and then the city changes its name. It's a sort of side note, and it played no role in the exhibition whatsoever, but it's also an interesting sort of side note to it. Here's the tower being paraded through Leningrad during some kind of march or procession in 25. It's also this idea of, in some of the books that we read, they refer to it as para-architecture, architecture that is either mobile or that is almost like a parasite, if you think of it, that is sort of, that isn't the hard architecture of the big buildings, but it's more like a soft architecture, this system of, again, kiosk and the street furniture, and this idea of the tower being mobile through a march also sort of emphasizes that. This is another example of this sort of para-architecture, linguistic para-architecture, or I don't know how clear the Klimisch is, by Popova. It's also for the meant as some kind of tribute to the Third International, or something that was imagined to take place during the Third International. This sort of zeppelins, like balloons that would carry these banners with slogans. It's funny that the constructivism for us is quite exotic in a way, because it's, we're also quite geographically removed from it. Although, in the Netherlands you had, for example, De Stijl, in Germany, Bauhaus, so there were all these related movements. Mm-hmm. But constructivism for us is fairly exotic. Well, for you it's much closer by, we realize. So maybe we're telling you all this stuff and you already know it, you know? That's probably pretty much. But then it's maybe interesting to see the complete sort of outsiders view on it. So now we get the break to our own work. We were talking about projects that never took place, or, you know, scale models. And so we were constantly thinking in the exhibition, how can we make that link between our work and these movements? So we came up with these sub-themes, and one of those sub-themes is indeed this idea of failed architecture or paper architecture. That might be a better word for it, this whole world of scale models. And we have lots of these. There are a lot of projects that we proposed, or we were asked to do something like that, and this is something that we proposed for, and we were asked by an artist basically if we wanted to think of a structure that would function as a museum store during an exhibition. It was an exhibition about moon life, and we made all these sketches and models that had to do with moon observer bases. And it's not this is, I think, a scale model that was actually realized, because this is not the scale model you see, but the actual thing. This is something that we did in Winterthur, an example of a typographic kiosk. Because we're quite interested in kiosks as structures that sort of exist in between graphic design and architecture, printed matter and architecture, basically. And this is an example of that. We were asked to create an installation for an exhibition in Winterthur, which is a place in Switzerland, near Zurich, actually. And because we're always quite interested in formats and standards, and it's part of a much bigger installation. You also see this sort of mural in the back, but this sort of kiosk structure was quite important for us to make, right?
I'm not sure. Maybe it was also a failed project.
A failed project, yeah. In retrospect.
Yeah.
Maybe we can still have to repurpose it into something useful. It's also maybe a bit cheesy, like, oh, it's A1 and then you got A1.
I think so.
But sometimes you think when you do something very literal, it also breaks the spell of it.
I like the image, though.
The image is good, you get a sort of, but no, you're true. So this is still an example of failed architecture, basically. But, the idea of typographic kiosk, typographic pavilions. In the exhibition, we linked constructivism also to some other movements. These are some examples more of Bauhaus kiosk, in which type and language was really used. There's also a reason, I think, why a lot of the kiosk in Russian constructivism, when you look at all those models and all those sketches, are all quite typographic or linguistic in nature. And that was, we came in some of the books that we read, we came across the fact that the person, I have to look at my note now, the person who actually was in charge of handing out the commissions to construct these kiosks, it was some kind of Soviet committee. Oh, it was called the Section for Artistic Labor, but it was headed by a poet and not an architect. So in a way, there was already in it the idea that it was more like almost like bringing poetry in the street. This is moving into another typology of kiosks that we also were looking at in our exhibition, which are kiosks that also think about sound as a language. For example, these drawings are quite beautiful by Klutzis, in which he sort of imagined all these systems of transmission and broadcasting, and with a sort of megaphones and speakers combined with type. Also, indeed, in the streets, in a more performative way, these megaphones were also quite an interesting gesture or prop. This is also quite a famous image, of course, from Mussorgsky, Lenin on his tribune, some kind of montage. Um,
Huh. Do you want to say something?
No, not really. I don't know. I feel quite blinded by the light. No, but what is also interesting is that we found, we recognized ourselves in a backward leap in the material, which is of course logical, I guess, because you know you come from somewhere, but we never actually take an idea and then just misuse it, or, but it's nice to see, it's very good to actually recognize yourself in things that already happen. And we found this image when we were working on the exhibition. And it remembered us of this project we did in Paris for Le 104, 104, where we used a sort of échafaudage or street furniture.
Scaffolding
in English, to make a sign system that resembles the streets, also because it was a passage.
Yeah.
It was actually two buildings connected with a glass roof, and the curators were interested in having this place transforming all the time. So we thought then maybe the sign system should not be connected to the building, also because actually this building was also a monument, so we could not
touch it
anyway, so it was very good that we had to make some sort of loose system. So we made actually this, do we have the drawing of that?
I think so, yeah. I mean, this whole typology of street furniture, mm-hmm. that we proposed as the sign system, basically, because indeed of all those reasons. On the one hand, we thought the scaffolding would refer to that it was constantly a work in progress, but we also wanted to refer to street furniture so that the exhibition space would look more like a street.
And the curators came from this more theater background, so also the things in the space would be more of a performative nature. So it actually would be very good prop-like thing to play with. But I think they only lasted for a few months, and then the mayor of Paris asked somebody else to take over. So this is actually also a failed project.
Well, but some of these were executed. We were the last time, and we still saw some of them standing there.
Behind, behind the wall.
They overruled the graphic identity, and there's now a new graphic design. So that whole plan never really took place, but there were some of these some of the smaller ones were actually executed. I think this is actually quite a good example of a project in which we work through the assignment. We came across more this sort of theoretical and philosophical ideas, because we are theory savages, or we know nothing basically. We also don't come from university background. And it were really the curators of this, or the directors of this space, who really were into Walter Benjamin, because they were working on this passage, on this arcade. So they said, yeah, an arcade project is really important for us. And that really got us into, I mean, of course we knew of Walter Benjamin, but that really got us into reading the arcade project, and also stimulated us to use this street furniture, because in certain parts Benjamin actually mentions street furniture, and also iron constructions. He's quite interested in these iron constructions, and so it's an example of that we really learned about Benjamin through the assignment rather than the other way around, right? Mm-hmm. We never really start with some kind of theory and then build something around it. It's always through assignments that we come across all these ideas, and then we use them in following assignments. But it's true that in this particular case that we came across this image and suddenly thought, wow, it looks so much like this thing that we designed in 2007, that is almost like some kind of being influenced retroactively or retrospectively. And we have that often, that we see things and think, wow, it's almost as if we can, as if we were inspired by it, which we are through time and through indirect sources, maybe through some kind of collective ether.
Yeah, it's more like probably a way of thinking more than have seen the images. Normally we actually don't use images in exhibitions either. I think that was also problematic with the last exhibition that we made, that we used all these images. And it's sort of because we know how tricky it is that you are immediately sucked into it and people see only these images of protest, while actually the exhibition was not about protest, it was really about the language in the city.
I know what you mean.
When we were done, we were also a bit surprised and shocked or disappointed by what we did. But okay.
You
don't know how to break it. I think that's also why we showed what I was already telling, that we showed that we got all the images out of books, basically. But it was not enough. You still only saw the images of rather than the actions or something. I don't know.
Let's
talk about it later.
It's the. I mean, this is still a whole part about typographic kiosk and. This is. I mean, again, when we say constructivism, we were also looking at some other movements. This is, for example, of a futurist pavilion by Depero. I really don't know how Italians pronounce it. Depero. But it's funny that this is basically a performance in the form of a book, so a piece of architecture in the form of a book, but he is also quite famous for his bolted book. It is in the sort of graphic design history and also futurist history, quite a famous book which is bolted together with bolts, which is, when you think of it, the opposite of this. This is architecture in the form of a book, and the other thing is book in the shape of architecture. So that's also sort of confusing those borders in a way. Scale, we were talking also a lot about scale. This is not strictly constructive. It's not constructivism at all. This is the decor of Metropolis. The German movie. But we like the image because it has a lot to do with scale. All these workshops where people were constructing these maquettes and scale models, and also here during the Bauhaus, and we connected this idea of scale in our exhibition with a previous exhibition that we made in Venice during the architectural biennial. We did the exhibition design of quite a big exhibition about Bakema, a Dutch structuralist architect, and he was also quite interested in scale, and we sort of emphasized that by also making all these modular objects that you could look at either as furniture or cities or scale models of buildings, and actually the whole exhibition was actually on scale one more deconstructed version of a shopping mall that he constructed in the 50s in Rotterdam, which is quite sort of for architects a famous shopping mall because it was one of the first sort of modern shopping malls in Rotterdam with a roof on top so that you could stay dry and that kind of stuff. So this was quite something we could show as an example of how we played with scale. Right?
Mm-hmm.
It's funny, this is only like the first theme and we still have three to go though. The situation is city. So four cities. And each city refers to how a certain movement interacts with that city through language. And I think one of the first things you then think about is, of course, the graffiti slogans. This is quite a famous image. It's from 52. It's De Boer wrote this on the wall, "Never work." So that is kind of sort of obvious way of how language is being used in the city in a sort of situationist way. Our whole thesis, how we approach this particular theme, was that we argued that the situationists saw the city as a sort of main text to which they added footnotes. The walking through the city, the famous the reefs that they did through the city was a form of almost reading the city, close reading the city, and all that sort of apparatus of graffiti and slogans and pamphlets, you could see almost like footnotes or annotations that they made to the sort of dominant text of the city. And later, this idea of footnoting the city became more apparent in a more applied way during, of course, the riots of May 68. It's funny, yesterday, I don't know if there were people here yesterday at the Rancière lecture.
Of course, you know that.
Oh, yeah, of course. I know some people, but I don't know how the overlap is between the experimental jet set fans and the Rancière fans. I don't think if there's actually quite a large overlap. But he talked quite a lot about barricades. In our exhibition, we showed quite a lot of barricades, and we argued that you could see it as a textual or even typographic device, almost a way to break up the street, almost like breaking up a sentence, like almost like the interpunction or punctuation marks in a street, like adding commas to the street or adding brackets to the street. And it was quite yesterday Rancière at a certain point talked about barricades as the invention of new spaces, new forms, and new worlds. But I actually understood new words, and I thought, yeah, that's right, new words, you know, because it's sort of when you think of it, a barricade. I mean, this is a very literal example of a sort of textual barricade. But the shapes of those barricades do almost function as signs, and this is really a beautiful image, but it's completely rasterized, marred. It are students on top of a barricade that is created from some movie billboards. It's impossible to see now, but the funny thing is that also on the billboard, it is from a movie in which Henry Fonda plays, and it's called Police sur la ville, police in the city. So it's also referring to the situation as well. So we thought these were quite good examples that he showed in our exhibition of the barricade as an almost typographic device. You also have that, of course, with this these stones and for example, the brick stone pattern, which we will get to later when we talk about Provo, is also a very graphic pattern, and here it's even represented as a typographic pattern or a texture almost, and in a way textures are also text in a way. You can read structures in a way, and there's a sort of expressiveness in this kind of ad hoc installations and barricades that is very much, it's almost like action painting, or it has a very abstract expressionist feel in a way. Also, of course, the idea of having typography in a more performative, having use in a more performative way. It's a strike in the Citroën factory. God, are you tired or not?
No, I love to listen to you.
Are you tired?
No. This is the break towards the diagrammic part of the... I mean, now we saw all these examples of language being used in a city. One of the interesting things about the Situationists was also that they... I mean, the way how the city manifested itself in their language and their visual language, the visual language of the Situationists was very diagrammatic. It's funny that for a group of people who are seems to be so against order and against structure, they were quite attracted to the language of diagrams, of maps, city plans, and of course it are exactly these dominant, almost scientific structures that can easily be subverted, because their attention is the biggest. So I think that is why people like De Boer, also Esker Jorn, there are a lot of quotes in which Esker Jorn is talking about the beauty of subway maps and that sort of love for the diagrammatic language, and then use a diagrammatic language almost in a sort of anti-diagrammatic way. That is quite typical for how the Situationist came to the visual language. So this is the famous, I mean, you can see it on the in the lower half, the famous map, the naked city that De Boer made by cutting up the map of Paris, sort of referring to this idea of psychogeography, the idea of drifting through the city in a sort of intuitive way. Which is a way of reading the city in a way. And these are all examples coming from the Situationist International that all refer to this idea of reading the city in a diagrammatic way. And then we make again a link to our own work and also the way in which we use often this sort of diagrammatic language in our work. And our work looks always quite systematic, while we're completely, in a way, non-systematic, quite a sort of irrational people. But somehow we always fool people into letting them believe in these quite sort of reassuring systematic images, right?
No, I don't think so. I think that's something that we need ourselves to...
that's also, that might be better... These are scale models that he made for for the exhibition design for something we did in China, in Beijing. A group exhibition on the theme of game theory. Well, the title was game theory. And so we came up with this idea of a whole playing ground or play field of a sort of board game, but then completely sort of deconstructed.
Mm-hmm. It had to do with the title, but also maybe because there were no walls that we could use, so we had to find a way to place structures so that could be used to work to hang the work, basically, right?
Yeah, absolutely. This is a small break
in between. And then we found this image when we were working on the exhibition.
And we thought, wow, this is another example of that we were already inspired by something that we haven't seen yet, which is this. It's too bad that Erwin is not here, because he would have known what this image was.
Yeah.
But it is actually something quite unexpected. It is a logotype. It is a logo of a Soviet organization.
Mm-hmm.
It's funny that they use this image as an actual logo, but this is the actual exhibition.
This is what it looked like when they installed it. We were not there, obviously. But shit, this was my thumb.
Yeah.
Okay, and this was.
This is how it
probably
eventually
the opening,
looked at.
A lot of people.
Yeah, we couldn't go there because at the same time we had a lecture somewhere else. But it was all installed according to our drawings, in a way. And there's the curator, Angela Girardi, on one image as well, yeah. The woman that you see on the right upper-hand corner being interviewed, she was the curator of this particular exhibition. So this was in 2014.
Yeah, what is funny is that it's quite lo-fi, and we always work with sort of standard paper, standard form, as an economic means, but somehow you notice when you do something in a different context that idea you have about formats and standards it's of course not the same. So you want something that is really simple and cheap, and they have to search for it, and it becomes all of a sudden maybe very expensive, and so you probably always have to go to the place and find out what the standards
are. It's particularly the size of the wooden boards here. We really wanted to know what is the standard size of these wooden boards so that they wouldn't have to be cut or sawn. You know, we just wanted to use the standard size because it's also very economical to do it like that. But for some reason it was impossible to get to know it because the people who were in charge of the product of the production just assumed they would have to custom make these boards.
Yeah.
That is what you're referring to, right?
I guess so.
This is another example where we were also trying to work in a sort of diagrammatic way and also slightly subverting it. It was a sheet of stamps that we designed for the Stedelijk Museum. It reopened and it was renovated. It had a new building attached to it. And it's hard maybe to see on this image, but we used a sort of, how do you say that, a door snede, a sliced cut through of the building, and sort of proposed an alternative route through the building. Those arrows basically referring to De Boer's Naked City. And then we, this was typical of the sort of assignments we have to do. The post wanted to emphasize the artworks and the museum. It was a sort of joint client that we had, a commissioner. It was both the Dutch post and the Dutch museum. And one of them wanted to emphasize the building and the other one wanted to emphasize the artworks.
And this is what you get.
So we, a sort of collage of both the building and the artworks and then the sort of alternative route through it. Even with the Whitney, which is when you think the graphic identity or graphic language, we also like to say to it sometimes, that we developed for the Whitney Museum in New York in 2012, we were also quite inspired by these tactics of, well, walking around in the city. This was during one of the presentations. We handed out to all the people involved of the stuff this map that he made, in which we grounded the W shape that he eventually designed for the Whitney, grounded it in the map of New York. Still about this idea of the derive, it's all sort of proposing routes and subverting maps, and maybe we should go to the provo part.
Yeah, so what you see here is also something that is actually not provo yet, but something that happened before provo, which is a sign that is later used by provo, but made by an artist called Bart Juchs. I think he's also
together with Robert Jasper Grootveld,
who was part of provo, but I think Bart Juchs was the one who sort of drilled a hole through his head to let his brain breathe.
In countercultural circles, especially in the Netherlands, Bart Juchs is famous. He was not part of provo, but more part of a sort of pre-provo sort of drugs culture, and who were doing happenings and stuff. And Bart Juchs is in fact the person who drilled a third eye in his head. So at some time it became quite popular in that time. I think there were more articles about it. Somehow they thought it would release some sort of air in your head, and you would get a constant high. You would develop like a constant high or something. It's total aside and side note to it, but it is that is true. In 1962, the first happening in Amsterdam took place, which was called a happening, and this was before provo. Provo took place from 69 to 67. In 62, there were already some people working within this context of happenings, and within one of these happenings, Robert Jasper Grootveld who became later some kind of guru type figure within the Provo movement, proposed this sign, this mark for the Provo movement. Or not for the Provo movement, but for the idea of Amsterdam as a magic city, magisch centrum Amsterdam. So he predicted that Amsterdam would become the magical center of all psychedelic activity of the world, and he thought that Amsterdam it's some kind of countercultural city marketing. Basically, he proposed this sign to be used as a logo, and it would represent all these things you see around, from a fetus to an apple to all these kind of sexual things. But also one of the things was also the map of Amsterdam, and it was in that capacity that it was later used by the Provo movement. They really saw this apple as a sort of simplified city plan of Amsterdam, where the stem stood for the Amstel River, the shape of the apple stood for the shape of the canals, and the dot stood for the Spuis Square, the location of the Spuis Square, which was the location where all the happenings took place. So we thought it was a good image to begin with, because it already shows a little bit the connection between the Provo movement and the city, that it was so important that Provo actually had as a logo a simplified map of the city of Amsterdam.
And one of the other things I did was sort of reappropriating the statues in the city. I think, so what you see here is a happening on a Saturday night with all the pamphlets, and they try to burn the statue. I think the actual name of the statue is Liefertje, which translates in...
The darling or something?
Yeah.
Or the darling boy or...
Mm-hmm. And
most of the main Provo happenings took place around this particular statue at Liefertje. For Provo, it symbolized a lot of things. What was quite important was that it was gifted to the city, the statue, through a smoking factory, a smoking company, right? Like Peter Stuyvesant or something. So for them, it symbolized both consumption culture, but also youth, because it's actually the statue of a little boy standing there.
Mm-hmm.
And for us, the way Provo used this whole system, because they used several statues in all the happenings, and all these statues had a particular meaning in each happening, and they all stood for specific prototypes or specific archetypes within the Provo narrative. These are all examples of Stil het Liefertje and all the happenings that took place around it. This is actually...
This is my father.
This is actually Marieke's father. This also a disclaimer. It was actually Marieke's father who was one of the main founders of this anarchist movement, and who later also became a printer. So for us, that sort of triangle between Provo, the city, and graphic design also has a very personal dimension.
This is another statue, Domela Nieuwenhuizen, and he represents, what would you say, the...
Maybe more the anarchist. Domela Nieuwenhuizen is quite an important figure within Dutch left-wing history. It was a really interesting figure. He had a couple of really interesting transformations. He actually started out as a priest and became a sort of atheist freethinker. He became, from a social democrat, he turned into more like an anarcho-socialist, really thinking more about the self-organization of workers. So more like a syndicatalist, or, you know, community communist in a way. So interested in people self-organizing. And he was a pacifist, vegetarian. He was in a lot of cases quite important. What's also quite interesting to us, at least, is that his son later became quite an important figure within the Stel movement. So for us, it's also an interesting... He also forms an interesting link between the Dutch sort of revolutionary left-wing scene and the Dutch avant-garde art scene. But this was also a really important figure within Provo, Domela Nieuwenhuis. And here you see a couple of Provos sort of hanging out near the statue of Domela Nieuwenhuis. And they often went there also to put flowers there. And The Dokwerker, which is a third statue that is quite important, not only within the Provo movement, but also within the workers' movement. And it was a statue that was erected to in tribute to the people who were on a strike. Harbor laborers, workers in the harbor, who went on a strike during the Nazi occupation, and because of that strike, they put this statue there after the Second World War, and it was still a very important statue also within the Provo movement. So they often had happenings either around het Lievertje, representing the youth, in a way, youth culture, or Domela Nieuwenhuis, which represented their more anarchist roots, the Dokwerker, which sort of referred more to the socialist roots, and there was also another statue, which we come to later, which sort of represented the arch enemy, Van Heuts, the Dutch colonial power. Another image, another series of images that we found quite important starts with this image, which is during quite important riots in the Netherlands, which had to do with workers against a right-wing newspaper, The Telegraaf. Somehow the workers confiscated these big rolls of paper. And together with the provosts, they rolled out these rolls of paper on the street. So these come from the printing workshop, the printer factory of the newspaper. And it's also a way, very literal way, to put printed matter in the street. Even the walking of people on the paper can be seen as a form of printing, leaving their footprints. Mm-hmm. And also the emptiness of the paper also has a sort of utopian meaning almost, a sort of white blank paper to be filled in by the people in the street. And we, in the exhibition, we let this image echoed with some other instances we found of paper being rolled out in the city, in this case by some Japanese artists who are part of the Zero movement. And this thing by Kriwet, a German Fluxus-related artist. Interesting about this is that yesterday at the Rancière lecture, somebody asked Rancière about his personal recollections of May 68, and he said that he particularly remembered the idea of walking in the street and discussing in the street, which is walking and talking in a way. And this sort of is a very literal illustration of walking and talking in the street, basically. So these in a way have nothing to do with Provo, but maybe they have. In a way there were some links between the Fluxus movement, the Zero movement and Provo. Although Provo was always more like an almost, you know, really like a political organization. There were often these overlaps with art movements of that time. Mm-hmm. So the printing part is also quite important within this story. The printing press of Provo. This is one of the places where the Provo magazine and all the pamphlets were being printed. At that time, to print something without permission was still illegal. You had to have a special permit to print something, and a lot of the Provo material was illegal. So all these print workshops were hidden. And they were always constantly on a constant drive through the city, but then with their printing presses going from basement to basement. At a certain point, the printing press was even
on a boat so that it could move very quickly
through the canals.
And not only through location, also the printing process moved from printing process to printing process. I mean, the print from mimeography to silk screen to offset printing all the time. It sort of changed. When you see all the printing of Provo together, you see this sort of development from mimeography, you know, stenciling, risograph, to silkscreen, to it got more and more stable, in a way, the printing. Here's again a picture of Rob, Marieke's father, handling the printing press during Provo times.
And of course, because we are graphic designers, that's also where our interest lies, is the printed material. Also because you have the representation in images of a movement, but actually the real content is always in the printed material. The funny thing is that actually my father stopped or self-liquidated this movement 2 years after its start, because from a movement it became more like an individual occupation. So actually there was not so much that bound these people together anymore, because they had all their own agenda. He sold this archive to the University of Amsterdam, and with this money he funded he sort of started a new
action committee.
Yeah, which was called Bureau de Kraker, which translates in Bureau de Squatter, I think.
Yeah, woning cooperation, living cooperation, the squatter.
So what we found interesting about that is that this one movement actually supports the next one financially as well. But since we had no material at all, because my father sort of handed over the material, we had to sort of recover or find it again. So we had to go again through the city to find all the things that were left in small bookstores and stuff. And that's also where we noticed that the role of the archivist is actually quite important in that sense. Really find the source of what was being said and done in the printed material, and to keep it was also quite important.
It's almost like a theme in itself, that sort of interaction between the archivist and the activist, in a way. And indeed, in a very literal sense, this happened with the Provo movement. Indeed, when Rob saw this movement, mm-hmm. and the money was being used for all these other action committees. And actually, Provo is at the beginning then of the original squatting movement in Amsterdam. It started around that time when Provo liquidated, through the money of the selling of the Provo movement.
Mm-hmm.
So that it's almost like a phoenix out of his ashes or something. You got this sort of regeneration of activist movements. Klaus, this is quite ironic when you think of it. A lot of the, around 66, a lot of the actions of Provo were geared towards the marriage of Princess Beatrix and Prince Klaus, which is, first some background, Beatrix, a Dutch princess, was going to be married with Prince Klaus, who had a sort of Nazi background, more or less. And of course, this was not that long after the war, so the war was still pretty much alive. And they wanted to do the wedding procession through Amsterdam, which people found was really almost like a sort of slap in their face, in a way. Because normally these processions take place in The Hague, which is more the place where all the royalty stuff happens, but Amsterdam was a very atypical place for this wedding procession to take place. So a lot of people were demonstrating against that. But the irony is, of course, is that this whole lecture or this whole manifestation is indeed sponsored by the Prince Klaus funds. So that is, I mean, where we're sitting now here, it is, in retrospect, I mean, Klaus was only part of the Hitler Jugend, which is basically where every kid maybe in Germany was being sent to, and it was not, and in retrospect, a lot of people acknowledged from the Kofa movement, when everybody got older, acknowledged the work that Klaus did, because Klaus also did some stuff for the apartheid, for the anti-apartheid movement, I think. And but anyway, it's ironic in a way that we're sitting here being sponsored by Klaus, showing all these images of Klaus next to actually a swastika. Can you see that on her? Yeah, you can see that on her jacket. We also got, I mean, the main reason why we show this image in the exhibition is, of course, because it's such a clear example again of printed matter being used within the context of a city. Mm-hmm. These pamphlets are also pamphlets that are used to wear almost, you know, like it very sort of like a bodily function they almost have, being pinned to. Yeah, we always have a discussion whether this is a boy or a girl. Not that it really matters. It's just a person, of course. Here's another image of the same person standing next to another person. Another example of printed matter sort of being implemented in the street. Maybe we should, I don't know. This is the Van Huyt monument. We already mentioned this. This is a monument for a Dutch general who colonized Indonesia. So he was sort of like the arch enemy of the Dutch Provo movement. So within this whole story of statues within the Provo movement, he sort of represented the arch enemy, Van Huyt. It's funny because now you have in the States a lot of these discussions about statues that have to be torn down because they are not related to slavery, and but this was already sort of prefigured by this kind of.
In this case, they also renamed it, I think.
Later.
I think recently. Actually.
Yeah, they.
Not
first
not
it
then.
Was a tribute to Van Huyt, and I mean the monument is still there, but they repurposed it. They, as in probably the city or the government or something, and it's now. More a neutrally named monument to something.
It doesn't even resemble a monument anymore.
It's not a celebration in a way. Or
this is the part where we start talking about, I think, also smoke screens.
Smoke screens.
I mean, we call them smoke screens. They were called smoke bombs in the 60s. They're preparing them. In fact, they are not bombs. Because they cannot inflict any damage. It's just a way to make things less visible in a way.
This is again Marieke's father here on the right and another Provo Peter Bronkhorst on the left while they are preparing smoke bombs. But we find the word bomb misleading in this case, smoke screens, to be used during the marriage of Klaus and Beatrix. The reason, I mean, smoke bomb was sort of invented by the right-wing press to sort of criminalize these devices because they don't really have an explosive mechanism. Mm-hmm. So it's strictly speaking not a bomb, but smoke bomb is still the most normal way to talk about it, but it's a sort of misleading way. But we often talk about it more like smoke screens. And here you see the funny thing is that the guy on the left, Peter Bronkhorst, was a typographer. He is a sort of trained as a typographer, while Rob later became a printer on the right. And in a way, you could argue that these smoke screens, they were in fact one of the earliest forms of language. So it is pretty much a printer's job that they were doing there. They were sort of preparing language. And the oldest language in the world, in the world.
What's in the world?
Which also brings us, oh, we always try to find all these sort of all these different connections between these different movements. And of course, with the constructivism, within the context of constructivism, these smoke signals also play the role, specifically in this composition by Arsene Afanov, Symphony for Factory Sirens and Chimneys. So the smoke from the factory chimneys was being used in one sort of audiovisual spectacle, really to let the factory sing in a way. It's also a case of how smoke was being used as a language, or at least as a communicative device. Here we've got Paris 68, where smoke was also being used. This afternoon we were talking about it, because we quite like the idea that a lot of these forms are being used over and over again. Some people think, oh, maybe that's nostalgic, or maybe that's some kind of... But they mean something different in every context, even though the gesture is the same. Mm-hmm. And it is exactly when we see this image of the factory with smoke coming from the chimneys, and this image of May 68, that you can also see in the way how smoke maybe is being used in the riots of 68, some kind of echo of the smoke coming out of the factories. There's always this sort of, the whole story of May 68 is always these two stories, the students and the workers, the factories and the universities, and that image of the factory is quite emblematic when you look at all those posters being produced in 68, those typical angular shapes of the roof. And but also smoke is also quite emblematic for mm-hmm. factories. So maybe in retrospect you can see the smoke here as referring in a way to those factories outside of Paris with their smoking chimneys. It's totally far-fetched, but it's just the way how we're thinking about these images in a way.
I think we can skip these images.
Yeah, I mean, it's taking longer than we sort of expected.
I think this is the... We wanted to use this image to talk a bit about the plants that they had profile, because they had all these white plants, and white referring to blanking something out to make the positive, I think. If you could say that the color black would then mean a negative, then the white would be a positive.
In today's atmosphere, more of identity politics, the whole idea of white plants sounds totally dubious or dangerous or something. Mm-hmm. But it was all the political proposals that the provost put forward, the sort of speculative plans, they always published them under this umbrella of the white plans. So for example, there was the white bicycle plan. This image refers to a white bicycle plan, which was a very practical plan that Provo put forward, that the whole city would be filled with white bikes that were free for everyone to use. You could always use them and go against the car traffic in a way. The funny thing is, it was never actually executed in Amsterdam, while later a lot of cities sort of adopted this city bike plans. Of course, then it was paid, or you had to put some kind of credit card next to it or something. But still, a lot of those plans in a sort of international, even in Paris, and a lot of those people behind those plans often refer to the Provo to the Provo proposal as their first the first instance of this kind of city bike plan. But this whiteness in the plans, there's a white bicycle plan, the white housing plan. I think there was something like 20 of those plans that in those 2 years they put forward through pamphlets, through articles, and in a way they were all quite useful. I think the legacy of Provo is sometimes really in these plans, which later also plans about how children should be taken care of through creches
and also
kindergarten.
The right to demonstrate. I think this is where this image is from. I think they were sort of that the mayor of Amsterdam. I'm sorry, I'm also tired. The mayor of Amsterdam told them not to go on the streets and demonstrate, so they reacted with this white banner. But actually, from this statement, the right to form a group and demonstrate appeared, I think.
Actually, to make it personal again, it's Marieke's mother on the left.
Yeah, but it is funny because actually my father ended this movement 2 years after its existence because they all hated each other, basically.
Not your father and your mother, though.
No. But and they all did very interesting things afterwards, actually. So it was maybe a good thing that they all split up because they had all different agendas and worked within that. I'm not sure where I'm heading. Maybe it was this image. Oh yeah, but it was after my father died that we sort of retraced this archive and try to understand what it meant also for us, because for him it was just 2 years, and after that he did things that he found much more interesting, formed this Bureau de Kraker, saved with a lot of people, like more like a communal thing, a whole neighborhood that was on the verge to be taken down by the
city. Which is where this image refers.
Because they wanted to have a big autobahn?
an highway.
A highway through the city. And they wanted to destroy all these houses. Also, these people had no housing, so they were fighting for housing. And this is actually one of the forms they found to protest against it. There were also real riots, quite heavy. But my father found working on this much more interesting, than this small
Provo movement. Those 2 years Provo. Yeah, the aftermath. A lot of people from the Provo movement all had much more interesting afterlives, actually. And this neighborhood, the Nieuwmarkt neighborhood, Nieuwmarkt area in Amsterdam, was on the list of being completely torn down, actually by the socialist city council, out of quite understandable reasons. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was total slum in a way, and the whole idea was a very old-fashioned idea that the workers were going to be moved to really sort of clean houses outside of the city, big houses, the Belmer, mm-hmm. that sort of projects, big projects of skyscrapers were planned outside of the city, and the workers would be moved there in a sort of new green environment, and they would tear down that whole part of the inner city, build office blocks there and a highway, and that was the thinking. And it were the Provo movement, or the people from the Provo movement that at that time was liquidated, but were sort of living in that neighborhood, that sort of mobilized the people of that neighborhood to sort of demonstrate against it. Mm. So it was a strange conflict, maybe within left-wing politics or something, where some
but
people were...
But the people that worked there, or lived there, they really wanted to have work and living together as an ideal, and not that the living would be separated as a schizophrenic idea. So it was just a different way of thinking about living, I guess.
Of urbanist planning. Now people acknowledge the value of old cities and also...
So now we live in a tourist trap.
Which is also, in retrospect, we think maybe they should have torn the whole thing down, and then we don't have all the tourists and all the sort of, you know, but it took 10 years, I think, that whole struggle, mm-hmm. and they saved most of the neighborhood.
But also the architects, they adjusted their plans to make better houses there, so they were working together in the end, which was actually quite good, I think.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Architects such as...
Yeah.
What's the name of the children playground?
Yes, yes.
Ah, come on.
Come on.
You know the name.
I know.
We blank out. Anyway,
yeah.
how we then connect that Provo thing with our own work?
Some things so far are really a stretch, but these are...
The idea of poetic slogans, poetic sloganeering or something. Provo were really well in bringing across, in a very clear way, messages that were in itself sometimes quite unclear,
mm-hmm.
or a bit cryptic, or esoteric, or even a bit occult. But it was always in a very clear way. The white, you know, those white plants also refer to a certain... sort of very functionalistic way almost of communicating.
And it always had to do with wordplay.
They were very interested indeed in very playful ways of using language, which is sometimes too bad because a lot of foreign people studying the Provo movement, they totally miss that. It's quite a big, I mean a lot of English people and American mm-hmm. people are looking into the Provo movement, and it's too bad that a lot of the wordplay and almost the, mm-hmm. the poetic wordplay get lost because they were really masters with language, and we sort of combined it with our own work where we are also trying to inject almost this sort of sense of poetry into the city. So this idea of the dialogue in the having a dialogue in the city.
Yeah, so this poster translates into Death is Blind, which is actually just a text that we took from the theater play. We thought not to use an image, of course, on the poster, but it would be more interesting to actually use the text of the play to make the posters with. So this is...
It's always two posters. We were reading all the theater plays that we, I mean, I think we worked for this theater company for, you know, 5 years, 6 years or something. And for all the theater plays that we had to do, we always read the theater play and tried to find a certain dialogue between mm-hmm. two different sentences. So we thought it's almost like a mini theater play in the city.
Mm-hmm.
You see one poster over here, one poster over there, and they sort of talk to each other.
And the more abstract, the better, because it would conjure up different meanings. The other one was Death is Blind, just as blind as you are.
Yeah,
but
we should have shown the other one here as well. That's why I linked to this. So this is an example of how they will look in the city. You know, I love you still, I love you with all my heart.
And this is more like a pop reference, because in the text they use the...
It's a Beatles
lyrics,
song.
Yeah.
So that's also why we use the red and the blue to get this sort of very Robert Indiana pop art.
It's quite nauseating if you see them in real, which is good, I think.
I think maybe here as well as in Melbourne, shall we skip the whole post-punk part?
Maybe then the next time we show it, we will... begin with the post-punk
part. Yeah. Yeah, a little bit. I think, okay, maybe we can go very quickly through it. First of all, we make some links with previous movements. The squatting is a big thing in the punk movement, also in the Provo movement. So we here combine these images of punks and actually people that were coming out of the Provo movement. This is again... Marieke's father actually standing on a balcony of a squat, and it says here.
He also made a poster of it.
Yeah. Ontruim.
Ontruim your eigen huis.
Yeah, just go and clear you out. It was against the police standing who wanted to deoccupy the house, basically, you know? So he says, deoccupy your own house. You know? The poster on the right said, don't put her children in the cold. So, because at that time the housing crisis was quite big.
We
so
also,
there was
because of the exhibition, people gave us all this material. It was really, quite special. We got this small movie of the squatting movement. from the 60s. And you can see them actually breaking the, well, it's a normal thing.
With a cow bar.
Yeah, the police, they take down the roof, so because then it starts leaking, people cannot live in it anymore.
Yeah, yeah.
But what is nicer is that in the movie, there's just people in the streets that walk by, and they actually agree with the people, the squatters, because people have a right to live somewhere. And so actually that of course now changed a lot, because instead of thinking that people should have housing, you should not touch other people's property or something. So that movie is quite important, I think. Maybe we should have bought it. I don't know. It's quite beautiful.
Another thing that sort of connects all these movements is still graffiti, which is almost like the great unifier of all movements and subcultures from the Roman antique world until now, basically. It's also interesting that walls become this palimpsest, this layering of all these different voices. So in that sense, something that really...
The street is a canvas.
Okay. The street is a canvas. Also a very concrete way of appropriating architecture, in the sense that the moment you put your name on it...
It's yours.
It's, well, yeah, but it changes also the meaning in a way. Of. Then we talk a bit about the Ballardian. We also thought that was an interesting way how punk and architecture, post-punk in this case specifically, and architecture sort of relates to each other. Ballard, the writer, J.G. Ballard, he of course came up with this whole body of work related to the dystopian image of the modern city in a way. And you see that echoed a lot in a lot of the post-punk sleeves and also songs, the words, the lyrics, that whole image of concrete jungles, test tube armies, that sort of high-rise cannibalism or primitivism, and that sort of almost love-hate relationship also with the dystopian side of the city. Clockwork Orange of course also plays a role in that, because that is a movie that both refers to that kind of brutalist landscape and also echoed quite profoundly in post-punk culture through skinhead culture, but also through some synth-pop things. Heaven 17, for example, the synth-pop band was named after a band that was named in the movie Clockwork Orange. So here we were looking at some of those images of the modern city in record sleeves. And it's always a love-hate relationship. It's never an outright criticism of the modern city. It's more like a sort of critical embrace of the modernity of the city. Sometimes a morbid fascination. And that is what they also have in common with Ballard itself, because Ballard was always quite ambivalent against modern architecture. Some people see his work as a sort of outright criticism of it, but there are actually quite a lot of interviews where he's actually describing some modernist buildings in quite a lovingly way. So when he describes a whole community of people turning into savages in a high-rise building, it's not necessarily that he criticizes that, he just loved the actual possibility of it in a sort of more nihilistic way. And that is what we think, that is then our thesis in this exhibition, they have in common with post-punk. Then we make this other turn in a way that is still has a lot to do with it, which is at a certain point post-punk makes this corporate turn. They start to actually mirror themselves with the corporate landscape of the city, and starts to present themselves either as corporations, as industrial units, as you know, it's a sort of like a boardroom aesthetics. You can see that with simple bands like Heaven 17, bands like 66 Sputnik, but even in the whole idea of industrial bands like Trom and Grissel, who are really presenting themselves as an industry. So they are sort of in an attempt to almost beat capitalism at its own game. They're mirroring these boardroom strategies, both as a way to criticize it, but at the same time there's also some sort of ambivalent admiration almost, of maybe that sort of anti-humanist corporatism. And we find this image in that sense quite important, because you see here Johnny Rotten, as a, you know, the vocalist of Public Image Limited, inserting himself and his t-shirt in that corporate landscape of Tokyo. The t-shirt, which is always quite a sort of trope of punk fashion, band merchandise, sort of blending in a quite a sort of natural way with that sort of neon skylight of Tokyo. And he is sort of in a sort of lo-fi way, in a sort of low-tech way, inserting himself in that corporate landscape. So that is then what we sort of see as a sort of ambivalent criticality of post-punk towards the corporate landscape. Or that is a sort of like the thesis we were sort of thinking of. It, I don't know, it's just a sort of, yeah, it's such a large movement in its sense. It's hard to find a common thread, but we try to sort of piece it together in this way. And then we make a link with her own work also, with this idea of fictional bands, fictional corporations, lost formats, which we also think have a lot to do with this sort of love-hate relationship that we have in a way with this idea of corporate landscapes, corporate formats. And so if we had to give you a quick rundown of what we did in that punk chapter, it would be that. Sorry it took much. When you said 2 hours, I thought, oh, we're never gonna take 2 hours, but half of the people already left, and it just, yeah, it went on too long. We know we should cut it down more precisely. But I said, the whole story is in that pamphlet, so there's much more structured and much more clear.
Well, maybe people have some questions. Yeah, you can moderate yourself, of course. Just raise your hand.
Sure, raise your hand if you got a question.
It's okay not to have questions.
Do you have some relationship with the exploration of the natural languages?
The exploration of natural
languages? Natural languages.
Natural languages, you mean animal languages?
No. Do you have any research for yourself, similarities or dissimilarities between different spoken languages that are referent to the city, urbanistic things? Different languages, different interaction and representation in the city. Do you research this?
No, but it is certainly interesting subject. I know it was not that systematic, I think, in our research. I understand what you mean. For example, why do we say stad, and in England they say city and mega city, metropolis? You mean, and how you can measure that, and how that
And how the local languages interpret the meaning of the city, of the town, what's the difference, and how it influences the urbanistic landscape?
No, we didn't look into it, but it's an interesting subject. Oh, yeah, because metropolis, the fact that polis refers to languages as police and political, I think also has its root in the same word as the pole, as metropole, and so it's definitely interesting. But we haven't looked, it's
the
maybe for you, maybe you can look into it. But it is for sure interesting.
Doing so.
Did you look into it?
It's hard to give one common time because it depends so much from project to project. We normally have some long-running projects that sometimes we have usually have some long-running projects that are going on almost in the background. For example, that Whitney graphic identity that we designed, we started working on that in 2011. And it was launched in 2013, so that was quite a long-running project. But then there are also a lot of these projects where people say, "Oh, okay, design a shirt for this, a shirt for that," and then sometimes we only work on it for a couple of hours. So there's this, all these different rhythms working at the same time, but they all interfere with each other in a good way. Some. You know, the long-running projects that we do create all these kind of spin-off projects that we can use for other instances. A little bit like the emblem for the.
I would like to ask if it was some impulse or it was the result, the conclusion of many processes, or you filled it and it was something a priori or a feeling for a feeling of such form for this emblem. That it was improvisation. If it was some abstract way, or it was more after research, thoughtful process. Yes, it was like abstract painting, or it was like symbolic.
In the specific case of this of the emblem, you mean? I think in when you think about or I think the symbolical and the abstract are always sort of alternating, are always sort of a lot of the things that we do sometimes quite intuitive and then we rationalize it, post-rationalize, which is quite a dirty word in design. People always said, "Oh, just post-rationalize it," but we always find it quite useful because the post-rationalizing is for us sometimes pretty much the pre-rationalizing for other projects. So by reflecting on our own work and sometimes things that we do in quite a sort of abstract or intuitive way, and by thinking about it, I said, wow, it's a spiral, maybe. And then we read something about spirals being some kind of metaphor for, I don't know, dialectical progress or something. And then we said, oh, that's interesting. We already did that or not. Or, you know, or, but we then incorporate it in our thinking and then we use it in following. So it's in a way both, you know, we it is.
Sometimes the research is also a way to fill the time. That sounds very negative too.
To fill or feel?
Fill.
Maybe you should speak in the microphone.
Yeah. to fill the time. No, because sometimes you have so much time to work on a project that you get overwhelmed by angst. So to dive into the subject more and to do research, you can sort of fill up this time up to the point that you have to perform it. and some things are best done in overnight, I think.
Over moments you were talking about what happened in the past, and my question is whether you believe in such moments today, whether this intervention in the city can be today.
I think a very important reason why we're so interested in this idea of interventions in the city as and the idea of the city as a platform for communication has a lot to do with the fact that it seems that a lot of that role now is being taken over by internet, social media, so-called social media, and more it becomes clear, of course, that social media is not the social or democratic platform that a lot of people believed in the beginning, right? You get information more or less algorithmically to you, and when I search something on Google, it looks different than when you search it on Google. We get different advertisements, but even if I book a flight based on my zip code, it is a different price than somebody else who books the same flight, because you know that. So it is quite a sort of fragmented and separated field of communication. While a poster hanging in the street, how old-fashioned it still feels, it still more or less says the same to everybody. Of course, people's interpretation might be different, but the poster more or less remains the same. So in a way, this research into the use of language in public spaces for us also is a way of examining, you know, the sort of social and democratic values of both printed matter and public space. They are connected to each other, and they are maybe now more needed than ever, because more and more you realize that social media fails, or actually might be slightly dangerous with, you know, all these things you now hear about political intervention in maybe Brexit, Trump, and you know that a lot of that might have to do with targeting specific people through online platforms. And so in that sense, I think there's something to be said for reimagining or re-examining the value of printed matter in public space, as nostalgic as it may sound. But yeah.
Am I right that all your works are presented in galleries or during some biennales, but not as
We are quite real sort of practicing graphic designers, in the sense that our work is in the public space. When you are walking around in Amsterdam, there are always basically posters that we designed, or designed the templates for Paradiso, or so it's not necessarily so that all our work only exists within that sort of gallery context. And I understand the critical subtext of it. You know, it's also very. You can argue that in a gallery, something is immediately dead, or you know, or so. But we also try to understand museums and gallery as sort of part of the public space, I think, right? It's just a sort of extension, or it is an extension in a way of public space, and it's maybe exactly because we are not coming from an art context but more from a graphic design context that we don't necessarily feel the need to get out of the gallery system, because it was never our system to begin with. We feel more glad that we managed to get in there, because it wasn't our space to begin with, and so we occupied the gallery space as non-artists, basically.
But also, we learned to embrace the fact. At first, we worked only within the context, and we thought that it should never be displayed somewhere. But now we also see that it's interesting when a thing becomes some sort of a time capsule of ideas. So actually, sometimes the afterlife is more beautiful than words. I mean, the piece of paper we design, they're just invitations for things. They're just pieces of small information. But they also embed a lot of our ways of thinking that are maybe more personal and therefore bigger, because they're important for us. And if you see them not being used for the context that they're made for, but as an abstract piece of information, actually sometimes they gain more. And not because they're important, because they're in a gallery, because it's what I said, it's quite embarrassing to hear a list like that, and also a bit intimidating, actually. But to physically see the object in a glass box, which you could say then it's dead, but it's not that, it's just not the thing it was before, it is an abstraction of that, and sometimes this abstraction is more important than the thing that it was. Some things are better dead than alive. What can I say?
Yeah, but I understand the criticality of the question. Actually, a lot of those May 68 posters, the original ones that were made by Atelier Populaire, they have this little sticker on the backside that the poster should never be in a museum. A stamp, little stamp on the backside that the poster should not be in a museum, and the poster should never be framed because it has to be in the city. And but then again, the only reason why we sort of learn about these posters is through the gallery also has an archive function.
As I think so, but also it's quite vain to tell somebody what to do with it, right? I think once it's not in your hands anymore, it's somebody else's. Yeah. So I think this stamp is also a bit... I like stamps, though. Shit. Oh, well. It's maybe just a way... Actually, it's not what it says, it's what it claims. Actually, they just want to say that they made it. But they found another way to talk about it, so you will feel guilty to want to have it. But they want to put their name on it, because actually all the material of Provo, which was before 68 actually, was not signed by anybody. Because it was like a communal thing, or that's what it started out, this idea. It was not about person, so it was also not about names so much. So yeah.
Anyway, you understand what we mean.
No, but I think to talk about all these really small, that's actually the small things is what makes it interesting. So also our eyes opened a lot going through the archives. I mean, it's like magic. You don't know what you have in your hands, and you try to understand things, and you're looking at things, and sometimes you just recognize them. Well, probably people that study know that it works like that, but for us it was really like an eye-opening going through all the found material and all of a sudden seeing things that maybe nobody saw. Actually, we found some things, like this person, he gave something that was related to the Provo magazine, and it was actually a sheet needed to be photographed for the printer. And I don't know, I've worked in my father's print shop, so I know how the material looks like, so I was ignorant and I did not look what it actually said. The person also just gave it to me as a nostalgic thing. And then I saw the real magazine at some point, and it was more like a scan. And I saw that it was not the same as the thing I saw that the man gave me. So I took the original, and I saw that there was a piece missing. So I thought this is either being censored, but then I thought no, actually the last one that has it in his hand is the printer, and it was written by the printer, which was my father. But so I knew that it was removed with a purpose. So it's quite magical.
It is a long story,
it's
quite
a
complicated
story,
but
so
it's a sort of detective work. Sometimes getting in the archive, it's
so
also
the
refers to
gives
your
you all these clues. So you really need also the.
It also refers a little bit to your because you said where did you get the material?
Yeah.
And indeed, we do get a lot of material. Also, I mean, there's a really beautiful archive in Amsterdam, the International Institute of Social History, which has a lot of profile material. We spend there quite a lot of time when we were working on especially the first profile projects that we did. And that this archiving thing is quite important. But the funny thing was, I was just reading the Book of Kiev, and there was this really nice word that they use as de-archiving, as this idea of giving it back from the archive to the people, which is also a very beautiful idea. So maybe this going back and forth between archiving and de-archiving, or maybe de-gallerizing and gallerizing, you know, maybe it is always that sort of dialectic or that rhythm between the two, that things move into a gallery space, maybe to be preserved through more difficult times, and then when times are right, they move out of the archive, they move out of the gallery, and suddenly they receive a new audience that is suddenly ready for it. And then, so it's maybe going back and forth from the street to the institutes in a sort of a tide, as in ebb and how do you call that? Well, like the sea, like going back and forth, like the sea on the beach or something. I don't know.
But also to see that all history is, I mean, everything in books is also quite subjective. To see the same material being used, misused, being used in different books in a different way, and also becoming very conscious of the fact that we are also using it the way we like. We show our, what we find interesting. It also gives you a broader... Well, it just gives you a different way of looking at the world, right?
Let's see if there's one more question, right?
Yeah.
But and then we declare
no
the whole
okay.
meeting ended. Okay, thank you all for coming.
Thank you. Thank you, Anne. Thanks a lot for your presentation. Tomorrow we are...